Let me start off by asking you guys a question. December 31st, 2013, New Year's Eve. Where were you?
At home.
Okay. I was half the way across the earth from where I live. It was in a slightly different situation. I was cuddling with a bunch of water bottles. You see, at this point, I was 8 days into my climb of Aconcagua. I was at Camp 1 at 4,700 meters. The temperatures over there would drop to way below 0 degrees Celsius at night. And this was the only way I could keep my water from freezing. I did have another bottle with me as well. This one served a slightly different purpose. You see, the altitude causes our bodies to need to use the toilet a lot more often compared to ground levels. And at the freezing temperatures over there, it's slightly inconvenient to have to put on your boots and jacket several times during the night to have to use a toilet. So that was our pee bottle. I could hear the wind blowing on the side of the tent. It would cause an echo to go on throughout the night. I had just come from an 8-hour hike and spent over an hour setting up tent. And it's been over a week since I last had any running water or electricity. At that point, I had as much clothes as I could on myself, as that was the only way I could stop myself from realizing how bad I really smelled. I pulled out my satellite phone to call my friends and family at home, see what their plans were for New Year's Eve. Those calls wouldn't carry much conversation, though, as it would take a good 10 to 15 seconds between every question and answer. And every 5 minutes or so, the satellites would be out of reach and the coverage would be lost. What I could gather from these conversations is that most either had fancy dinner plans or going out with friends and family to watch the fireworks. Meanwhile, I was there in the cold darkness, my 2-meter by 2-meter tent. I went to bed at around 10 p.m. and woke up the next morning at 6 a.m. That was how my year began. It didn't start with any fancy dinner plans or any fireworks, but I woke up happy. I was on Aconcagua in Argentina, the second highest of the 7 summits, and I was doing something that I loved. And to me, that was a perfect start to the year 2014. And that made me realize that it doesn't take much to create memorable moments. You don't necessarily need to be in a 5-star hotel or 3-Michelin-star restaurant to create a memorable moment. Those do help create memorable settings. However, it's actually the experiences that we have that create memorable moments. That also taught me to be comfortable being uncomfortable. You see, from that trip, I went straight with my family to a 1-week vacation. We stayed at a pretty decent hotel, but you know, you always have the comments of the beds being uncomfortable or the rooms not being the way they should be. Personally, for me, the beds felt like heaven after sleeping on the floor. What I enjoyed most, actually, were the showers. I'd spent hours just sitting on the floor underneath the shower, astonished by the invention of running water. And that made me realize how many things in our daily lives we consider necessities, but they're merely luxuries. We've gotten so used to having all this around us that makes it hard for us to imagine life without these stuff. I've been told by the organizers that this hall has selective Wi-Fi access, so I bet you can find at least a few people at the back that are having slight panic attacks due to that. Calm down, it's not the end of the world. From there on, it was around 6 days till we reached the summit at 6,962 meters. That's equivalent to 8.5 Burj Khalifa stacked one in front of the other. It's a bit hard to perceive, but I hope this graphic will allow you to imagine it. They were not necessarily the most pleasant 6 days. You see, the higher we'd climb, the conditions would get worse and worse. The temperature would fluctuate between 15 degrees Celsius during the day and negative 20 degrees Celsius at night. The higher we climbed also, the air kept getting thinner and thinner. By the time we got to the summit, the amount of oxygen we'd get per breath was less than 50% what we'd receive at the ground level. The higher we climbed, the winds kept getting worse and worse. We'd spend hours just taking shelter inside our tents, trying to escape the 60 kilometer per hour winds. After a while, that starts playing games in your mind as well. And then came the 12-hour summit day. Had I kept all these obstacles in mind from the start, I would never have been able to make it. But what allowed me to push through with it was take it one at a time as they came. The mountain would throw an obstacle at me, and I'd deal with it and move on to the next. The same goes for the summit day. If I was to look at it as one long 12-hour uphill hike, I would never have thought I'd be able to make it. But the mountain teaches you to take it one step at a time, one foot in front of the other. Whenever you feel your legs don't have the strength to make it all the way to the top, all you need is to find the strength for that one more step, and then the one after that, and the one after that. That also taught me that our bodies are capable of a lot more than we think they are. We learn to tell ourselves that we have limits. There's only a certain limit to which we can push our bodies, and we cannot go beyond that. If that's the mindset we are in, those will always be our limits. We will never be able to achieve anything we think is beyond our limit. But the mountain told me that our bodies don't really have any limits. We are capable of achieving a lot more than we think we are. And that's what led me to calisthenics. When I first started doing calisthenics, I never thought I'd be able to pull up most of the moves that I'd see on Instagram or on YouTube. But by going through simple progressions, I soon learned that there's very little you cannot teach your body to do. Even the most advanced moves usually start with the simplest progressions. And that has influenced me a lot in my daily life. You see, at the moment, I'm a student of architecture in my senior year. I've also recently opened my own business, Gravity Calisthenics Gym, where I'm also a trainer. And I also practice mountaineering on a regular basis. Each one of these on their own are full-time commitments. And I find myself at times overwhelmed by the commitments of each. But that's when I go back to what the mountain taught me, one step at a time. I deal with one issue at a time, and then move on to the next, and so on. And before I know it, I have them all resolved. So that's how I start my summit day. Then 9 hours later, 9 hours after leaving camp, 9 hours of telling myself one foot in front of the other, I took one last step, and there I was, the summit of Aconcagua, the rooftop of South America. At that moment, I was just overwhelmed by emotion, and I broke down into tears. But if I was to go back and relive that moment, everything was pretty ordinary. The summit was no spectacular summit. The views, they were nice, but it wasn't much different than the views that I had for the previous 2 weeks on the mountain. So why the overwhelming emotion? To be honest, to this day, I don't really fully understand why. What I think it is a sudden realization of what you have accomplished, of what you are capable of. The mountain threw everything it had at you, and you pushed through with it. You pushed with all your strength, not your physical strength. Now, that's only a small part of the struggle. What you really push with is your mental strength. The countless hours spent in the isolation of your tent, trying to skip 60 kilometer per hour winds, the hours spent hiking from camp to camp, knowing that after only a few hours of sleep on the Rocky Mountain floor, you'll be up in the morning at 6 a.m., packing your stuff and telling yourself, one foot in front of the other. Knowing that at any moment, conditions can change and the mountain could very easily claim your life. That's when you realize who you really are. You realize your true strength. Everything you came across on the mountain was not a problem holding you back. It was a challenge you had to overcome. And only by challenging yourself do you realize the true strength you really have. Thank you.